What's going on, guys?
Hey.
That was a really weird opening.
That was
but,
weird.
You gotta try and make it different each time. You know, it has to be kind of a...
It was very awkward. It was like the first time you ever went up to a microphone. You're like,
hey, guys.
But yeah, we're doing the MDRM movie cast today.
Movies.
But yeah, so as always, we're gonna start off with a what are we watching segment, or what have we watched. So, you have some beady, shifty little eyes over there, Alejandro.
I'm shifty because...
Can I get my positivity first before you go on your rant?
That's good. You know, yeah, start on it.
I've been watching Bill Nye Saves the World.
Oh, shit, how's that?
It's great. I love it. It's more of a man's, you know what I mean?
He's just
like, he's repping the good stuff. He's got the smart, he went right in on climate change. Like, cool. Right in, first thing. And, like, he even, like, acknowledged it. He was like, you thought I wasn't going to get a new show and not talk about climate change? And it's great. I mean, there's nothing more I can say about it. You all saw it?
Yeah, I haven't seen it. I haven't seen the show, but I want to.
You've seen Science Guy.
Oh, of course.
We've all seen Science Guy. It's more Science Guy, more adult.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're talking, like, a adult slash late teen to early adult. Oriented science talk
show.
Yeah,
and when I say more adult, I don't mean like he's like using profanities or anything.
No, of course.
I mean,
like, he's just being more sophisticated. More
using like naked women to like, display things.
Yes. He had a...
On the labia here, we can see.
Oh my God.
Mateo, did you see it yet?
What?
Bill Nye Saves the World?
No, I don't like him.
Oh, Mateo doesn't like Bill Nye.
Doesn't like Bill Nye.
Well, now we know why this is the movie show.
Oh. But Designer was on the first episode, and it's hilarious. Oh, you really? Should just watch that bit. Anyway.
Yeah.
That's it.
Cool.
Good. I like that.
So let's throw Alejandro's negativity.
Negativity. Okay. All right. You know what? I'm a dude who enjoys the finer things in life.
Oh, boy.
When I talk about the finer things in life, sometimes I enjoy a nice, like, chick flick or chick-based show. All right. I ran into two that I'm not digging. Okay. I'm a big Broad City boy. Okay.
Right.
I like me some Broad City.
Broad City's not like a chick show.
Chick. Oh, come on.
It's just about chicks.
But it's obviously centered towards millennials of that same, like, you know,
sure.
I know those people. Like, I know those girls exist because I've seen them. I've hung out with them.
Right.
That's their show. They love that show because it's a representation of their life, essentially.
Okay.
You know, the wacky, zany adventures of two 20-year-old millennials who are getting into some shenanigans and partying, you know?
Mm.
It's a chick show. It's just a new age chick show.
Right.
Yeah, don't you fight me on this.
All right.
Anyways, I'm a man who enjoys my chick show.
I think you're wrong.
But anyway, continue. It doesn't matter.
I think you're wrong.
Well, we're gonna go and go back to Vern's pick of the month.
Okay.
Right. The brand new 13 Reasons Why.
13 Reasons Why.
And let me state by or start this by stating that the show is very well done. Each episode has different directors, of course. It's not completely consistent throughout, aside from the script and writing and all that. But it's a very well done show with good camera work and delivery, and it has the good old ups and downs of any show. You know, it's a good thing. Though, fuck that show. just screw that main character.
Yes.
Screw everything about it. Okay.
Yes.
It's so like needy and obsessive with its own, what it's trying to spew out, but it's like, it's all just nonsensical bullshit, okay? All right, do you know the premise?
I know the premise. Ava was telling me she was watching it, and I don't know anything about it.
Should I go into any kind of...
Well, all I know, okay, well, no, I know that it's about a girl who kills herself.
Yes.
Yep.
And gives out these tapes to people. That, like, helped her aid in her wanting to kill herself.
Yes.
And, I mean, I just didn't like the idea. Thought it was very, like, romanticizing mental illness and stuff. Not to get all into, like, you know, this, like, social justice type of stuff. But, like, you know, I just thought it sounded like a lame concept.
Yeah, kind of like Edgelord 2017.
Yeah, and I thought, like, Ava would just kind of found it on Netflix and was watching it. And then, like, a day later, I go on Twitter and everybody's watching
it's a book, just so you know. It's based off of an actual novel.
I've seen it a couple times at work.
Yeah, I agree, though. Like, I've seen a little bit of, like, one episode, but I agree. I think the concept's pretty lame as well. I don't think it
could have some good ending. I don't know. But.
No, that's specifically why I'm so mad at the show. For a show that's trying to, you know, get the audience and the characters to understand why this girl pushed herself to her own death.
Mm.
In reality, it's more so the plot kind of takes itself in a different direction. The only character who actually ends up caring for the girl who killed herself, Hannah Baker, is the main character, Clay. He's the only one who's devastated. No one else gives a fuck. Like, and this is almost undoubtedly true. Like, people can argue against me on that, but like, realistically, there's only one reason why everyone cares, and it's because there's a hidden secret. There's a guy on the tapes who did some very foul things that's basically only ever mentioned in the tapes, right? And the whole focus of the show aims towards that one thing, while Clay's like, I just want, what happened to him? I just miss her. All right. And it's just, the only reason why I find this really annoying is that she failed in her mission. She wanted to get revenge on these people, right? And she failed. She failed. And I mean, if you think about it, it all aims back towards the one specific character, one dude, you know? But even then, we don't know what
I'm very interested in what he's saying.
It looks like you were like, you're like,
no, I'm not. I know that's, it's very similar to my like beginning to roast.
It did look like you're about to roast him.
But I'm actually listening.
I dig what you're putting down.
Yes. And the only reason why this also just frustrates me is if her goal was not to get back to all these people, but one specific person with these tapes, she almost succeeds. But she could have done it when she was alive. And the worst part, is in the last few episodes, there's a scene where she has like the biggest, fattest, sloppiest like opportunity in her face. And she doesn't take it. And people are defending her character online, insisting that it was too fresh, it was too traumatic of an event. Things happened that shook her up and she couldn't come forward to it. Right? Mm-hmm. She even recording on this tape is like, this is my last chance. This is it. You know, if nothing happens today, then I'm just gonna do it later today, you know? Mm-hmm. As in like, yeah. And once again, the problem is this show just it literally it puts forward what teens do. They just care about the attention that they can get.
Right. You know,
at the end of the day, it's missing something very, very focal where the person who is feeling bad, down, sad, depressed, miserable, ready to off themselves, you know, should seek help. And every opportunity where she was able to seek help and was trying to,
yeah.
I'm going to do the trying because she didn't fucking try. Okay. Yeah. She doesn't. She pushes people away. Right. It's, I don't know. This is what heats me up because like, especially when she had the chance to get the revenge that she needed. Not even revenge, just get the right ending, you know, to what happened to her.
Okay, yeah.
Was in her face, and she couldn't take it. She didn't take her opportunity. In other words, don't be lame.
Yeah. So she sounds like they're like a super like just obnoxious character then, right? Like she's just like kind of an idiot.
Yeah. I mean, like there's a half and half because there's the part of me that understands like certain things and how people don't always function with the same mental thought, you know,
right.
Like, not everyone takes the same approach to things.
But when you're watching something, for entertainment and then the main character is just like doing everything that
wrong.
You're just like, no, like every turn. It's just like, this is stupid. Like
that's her literal character. She is the emphasis of that character. Mm. She's the emphasis of, I will do literally everything in my power to mess up.
Right.
And you know, the main character, Clay, he does everything right, you know? Yeah. And sometimes it just sucks seeing the good guy who should have won still kind of just suffers throughout the end. And that's all she did to him. Mm-hmm. So, you know what? Fuck that book. Fuck that show. All right?
I love it. I love just like Alejandro.
But I enjoyed my time with watching with Vern. We actually did watch a lot together. I was very happy with our time spent, all 13 episodes.
13 reasons.
But I just wanted to get the rant out. All right. To people who watch the show and who enjoy the show, I'm glad that you do. You know, I'm a little too old for what it was trying to convey.
How old are you, Alejandro?
I'm old.
Give us the number.
I'm that woman who doesn't want to speak her age. You know?
You're not that old anyways.
It's
not even that embarrassing.
I'm 24. Okay.
It's 24.
It's definitely meant for like 16 through 20s.
You're old! Anyway, no. But I mean, I just, it has no, like, I don't know, like, just these like, tragedy tales of teenagers, just, like, you know, teenagers don't, a lot of times, have enough to, like, you know, it's not even, like, teenagers, it's this, like, I can't even put into words.
It's difficult. I had
to say, put into words.
Teenagers are morons.
It's
like, to some extent.
It's like the high school drama stuff in shows. Don't give a shit about it.
Let me spoil one thing
Quick. Don't give a shit.
You both are going to be like, that's so stupid. Want to know one of the reasons why she was so upset? Like, so upset. All right, you ready for this? You ready for this? First of all, how often, all right, if you're dating a girl, right, as you guys are,
yes,
how often do other guys, like, hit on them or whistle at them or just act stupid? The point is, like, how often do they get hit on? It happens, right?
Sure.
Every once in a while.
Yeah, but it happens. Sure. It's something that women have to deal with, and it does suck. It's terrible, and they shouldn't, of course, but it happens. Some Mexican groped her hand the other day. You know, and she's
some
like,
Mexican.
Okay. Mexican.
He didn't say that. He's
it's something that happens. All right, Hannah, the main character, she gets added onto a list of girls of best and worst.
Yeah,
and she was voted best ass.
Uh huh. And she's upset about that.
Yes, that's like a whole.
Why are you upset about
that? That's literally like an episode of her explaining.
I don't know if the
Mateo savagery
that was fucking hilarious.
But the point is, yeah. So if you guys can understand, and mind you, there are some things that do happen to her that are very, very foul.
Sure. Yeah. But you're right. That like I can't take a show seriously
if that's one of the representations.
If that's one of the reasons why she killed herself is that she was, you know, objectified.
As a message to everyone, if you feel alone, if you feel scared, if you feel like you can't hold on much longer, reach out.
Reach out to Alejandro, because he will be very...
I meant to your friends.
And, yeah, he was just like, fuck that show, fuck that book.
But that's the truth. That's the truth to it, you know? No. Like, don't push that shit forward.
Right. But no, yeah, you're right. And you're right. Also right, Tyler, is like the whole, like, high school, teenage year drama stuff is just like... I mean, it's meant for that age, you know, like, you know, that's 13 Reasons Why seems like a high schooler show.
It is, you know, granted, I'm not, like I said, I'm not of the audience.
That's fine. I'm not like disparaging anybody for liking it.
It's like people like Skins, you know?
No, we're not like, anyone who likes anything.
Second season of Skins was pretty good.
You were also the right age for that show.
At the time, I was watching it, I was of that applicable age.
Yes. But no, we're not coming at anyone who likes anything. It's just talking about the show itself.
Yes.
You know, it's we can have our opinion, and that our opinion is it's stupid.
Or rather, let's put it this way. Hannah's stupid.
Hannah's stupid.
Watching, Carl?
Man, I don't even know. I'm not like watching any shows.
Watch that last Jedi trailer. Trailer like 18 times, didn't you?
Traitor. Yes.
No. Getting on this. Yeah. I'm going to do it way later in the episode.
Yeah. I don't know. I haven't really been watching any like shows consistently.
What'd you see last night?
Oh, yeah. Last night I saw Beauty and the Beast.
How? Did you like it?
I did like it. It was, I'm not super familiar with the original. I've seen it, of course, but I didn't like remember. I remember like the main story beats, but that's it. And I don't know. I thought it was really good. Emma Watson's great as Belle. She's playing perfect. And what was it you that you were saying that like she wasn't like you didn't like the idea of her playing Belle or something?
I still don't see it, but once again, I
haven't
seen
it.
How do you not see that?
Like she's so like Emma Watson is the only person
she is
I could honestly see in real life playing Belle.
You know who I see more so than Emma Watson? I see someone like you know who has actually a good
I'm waiting
physical depiction.
I'm waiting.
If oh, it's your bae. What's your bae's name?
I have like five.
No, your main, the one you want the skin of.
Oh, Anne Hathaway.
I can see her. She has the bigger eyes. She has the fair skin. She has, if she just needs the brown hair, I can still see her better than, like, literally, if you take a side by side picture, it's closer than Emma Watson to the character, you know. And that's, like I said, we've talked about this. The whole representation of characters, if I've seen a physical depiction of them, I want them to be close to that physical depiction that I've already seen.
Okay, hold on. Anne Hathaway, yeah, sure. Like, she looks like she could be a good Belle. But you know why she can't? She's too old.
She is too old.
Emma Watson is a good age.
She's younger, but once again, I just don't see her face. It's not in the face. She's adorable. Don't get me wrong. It's not that. It's just, same thing, like Spider-Man, you know?
Well, you're wrong.
I have an idea of how Peter Parker looks.
You're wrong.
You're wrong. Go on. We're going.
No,
We're moving on.
Oh, my God. Okay. But no. Emma Watson's perfect as Belle. Shut the fuck up.
I'll watch it. We'll come back to this. Right.
She sings well. Yeah, Kevin Kline in there. We got Luke Evans. fucking Josh Gad. And Josh Gad, I thought was great. He was very funny. He was the comic relief of the movie, and he was dope. Also, comic relief was the fucking awesome dynamic Lumiere and Cogsworth. We had Ewan McGregor and Ian McKellen.
Mm.
How was it?
That's cute.
Fucking great. They were so cute. They were so cute together. And the Beast was good. The actor was really good. And I don't know, like there was moments where I thought the CG on the Beast was like not that great, but he's like all hair. So I guess, I mean, hair is like one of the hardest things to like animate. Right.
Yeah.
But so I feel like in 10 years, like it won't look very good. But, there was one scene where the Beast was like taking a bath and he came up and he's all like, he was like soaked and it looked, I was like, oh,
it just didn't look good at all.
Yeah. But,
some,
I enjoyed the experience.
Yeah.
So some good songs in there that are stuck in my head still. So there's that.
I like to hear this. It's a good sign.
Yeah. Catchy stuff. Yeah. But cool. All right. So moving on from what are we watching? We're gonna spend the rest of the episode really just talking about you guys did this on the games show. It was the god tier of games. Now we're doing god tier
of
movies. Cinema.
I was hoping you'd say that a little more bolsterous.
Talkies.
Boisterously, you know.
So, we're going to be doing about five each for our god tiers. How do we want to do this? We want to just do 5-5-5?
Let's do what we did. Let's go around.
Okay. So, we'll start with Alejandro.
And we're not starting with chronological order or anything. Just fives, right?
And
fives.
Keep in mind, everybody, this is not like the best movies ever made, because I know for a fucking fact that the movies that I chose on my list are not like the greatest movies ever made, like Academy Award winners or shit. It's shit that I like.
Mateo's going to be scoffing the entire time.
Mateo is going to be such a fucking douche about
Annie
this.
Hall's not there, so it's not a good list.
Annie Hall is not on any of our lists, and I want you to accept that right the fuck now.
I was going to let Carl put lists on the game one.
Yeah.
I was going to let him put games on that.
Okay.
I'm not gonna fucking do it anymore.
What? Well, you are a spiteful. Okay.
Wait, can we wait you 1 second then? To be fair, Mateo. Annie Hall is at least on the top 20 of most dedicated 100 top lists of all time for movies. So,
you have a great.
This is just mindset. The MDR. Like this means nothing. Like, right?
These are our individual
number
lists.
Five for me.
Individual lists. Alejandro.
Okay, my number five movie of all time.
Is this an order for you?
For me, it's an order. Oh, but that's just.
He did it on the games, too.
Okay. It's the way I think of things. I list out what I enjoy more.
Go.
Before we start this.
Of course we have an intro.
Just know that for me, top five movies are mostly representations of movies that I can watch
over and over and over.
Oh, almost whenever. Okay. You know, I don't have to be in a specific mood. Right. They're just that good. They're that good that I can just watch them. Okay. All right. Number five, Whiplash.
Okay.
Whiplash is a great fucking movie.
Whiplash.
Okay. Yeah.
I can get on board with that.
It's just, oh my God. It's like, it's so dramatic without even needing to try. And yet, at the same time,
that ending made me want to pee. It was so good.
That movie is fucking dope. That's one of my favorite endings to any movie, probably. I remember I was in, I major in film.
Yes.
And one of my classes, like a few semesters ago, my second semester of college, I took this class called like camera and cinematography, and that was around the time when Whiplash came out.
Yeah,
it was in theaters and stuff, and my teacher was roasting Whiplash.
Roasting.
Yeah, he was like me and my friend Ben were in that class, and he was talking about how much he loved the ending, and then my teacher was like, if he even had an ending.
It had one of the best endings of all
modern
time.
Cinema.
Right. Yes. And he was like, it didn't really have an ending. And this was my fucking teacher, man. And I was like, what the fuck?
He has to respect you?
Yeah.
Like, at that point, what do you even do? That movie still has, I think, at least a 90%, if not higher.
Right.
Because it's just so fucking fresh.
Yeah.
You know?
It's so fresh.
It's so fresh.
So juicy.
As you guys know, like, it was a movie I put on in the background.
Right.
To fall asleep to.
Oh, yeah. And you were like,
stood out of bed. Yeah. Walk close to the TV. So into it.
You told me that before. You like just like stood up to watch it. You're just like standing there in front of the TV.
And Vern's like, what are you doing? Like, shh, shh. This is so good. Like, that's one movie that can literally rise me from the grave, okay?
Wow.
That's how good that is, okay?
I watched it with you for the first time, remember? And you don't remember this at all?
No, I don't.
No, okay. Well,
I might. eventually.
I just remember it ended. Like, we were like, it was me, you, and Allie. Usually we're talking through stuff. We did not say a word. Like, the whole
it's that mesmerizing.
It is mesmerizing. That's a good way to describe it. It's just like, it's on, and you're just like locked in.
You're so, like, it's something about the human drama in it. It's so, so goddamn absorbing. You know, and you cannot look away for even 2 seconds.
And you can't, like, deny that, like, a lot of that is due to J.K. fucking Simmons.
Man. Oh, dude.
He's so
his performance is nuts.
Good. In bonkers. That movie.
He's that, so like, good. 1 to 100 kind of anger range is just...
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I mean, that was the movie that, like, brought him into, like, true... Like, everyone was like, holy shit, this guy is actually dope as shit.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm. Like, before that, Spider-Man.
Spider-Man. Yeah. And now he's in a bunch of stuff, so...
Yeah.
All right, so we'll go to me next, which...
Give your shout-out. Come on, let's hear it. Let's hear it.
I'm just trying to decide which one to go with first. I'll go with Attack of the Clones. Yep. I'll go with the one black and white movie I decided to put on my list, which is 12 Angry Men.
12 Angry Men.
Have you seen it?
I've never.
Seen it. Do you know what it's about?
Nope.
No.
Sounds like 12 very not happy guys.
12 ferocious
people with dicks.
Yes.
Y'all roast me in my lap all the time.
So it came out in 1957, I think. And this was a movie I saw kind of on accident. It was just on. It came on. I didn't like put it on, you know. Mm-hmm. And I got kind of transfixed by it as well. I heard about it. It's about a court case. And it's set entirely in one room, which is the jury trying to debate if this kid who is guilty of murder or not, or whatever. It's like a young Latino kid.
Okay.
And he was being tried for murder. It was the evidence was like overwhelmingly against him. Like, he was very seemingly guilty. And these 12 guys, you know, in the room trying to figure it out or whatever, trying to go through it. It's all set in the one room. It starts off, everyone thinks he's guilty except for one guy. And then throughout the movie, the one guy is able to convince everybody that he's not guilty. And through that, that's the plot of the movie, but through that you learn about all these different characters, and they all have, like, some of them have very deep-seated reasons why they want this kid to be guilty. Maybe it's like a race thing, or this one guy has problems with his own younger son, so he's like projecting his issues with his son on this
Lord.
Kid.
This sounds amazing.
So it's like everyone has their own thing.
Yeah.
And eventually they all decide that he's not guilty, and super cool how it happens. And it was between that one and It's a Wonderful Life I was going to put on my list. But It's a Wonderful Life has more nostalgia for me. Mm-hmm. But I put this movie above it because of the fact that...
It's just a better movie?
I think it's a better movie. And also just the fact that it's all set in one room and it's able to like keep you completely like locked in for that entire movie.
Yeah.
You know, that's
incredible.
Any movie that can set an entire movie in one place is like that's a feat.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's
and to have so much character development too from what you're saying, like that sounds like I want to watch it now because it sounds like, oh my god, what can I get at my, you know, what am I gonna learn here?
It's pretty emotional, man. Yeah, it's dope. But also just the fact that it is about like a young Latino guy, kid, and there you go. It came out in the '50s, so you know, racism very
very
like, prevalent
high. Yes.
In that time. So the fact that it kind of like hit that a little bit, you know, is kind of cool at the time. So, anyways. Moving on to Teeter Dealer.
All right, let's see. I got to pick which one, like you said, the first one.
First one to go with.
My first pick, The Room. Alien.
Alien.
Good one. Ooh, good one.
Okay. Alien is...
I dig.
Number one on my list.
I would say
like
that's...
Like number one.
Wait, no. Not on my, like the first one out there.
Gotcha.
Alien is like the epitome of... Like the best a creature feature I think can be.
Mm. Yeah, I think I can greatly agree with that. It's my favorite out of all of those original thrillers / horrors. You know, it's super suspenseful, super well done, and
I like how it is a really good combo of like sci-fi and horror.
Yeah, and like I don't know, just the progression of the movie is it paces perfectly.
Yeah.
And it's like we were talking about this the other day. It still looks good. Doesn't look that dated, really.
Cheesy, really. Yeah.
And in this is like one of the only cases I will say that the director's cut is better than the theatrical.
The original.
Yes. there's like this one shot, like, it's the way that they introduce the alien in the director's cut.
Oh, right. Like, that's a cool shot.
It's creepy as fuck, dude. It's like, in almost every, like, monster movie like that, there's this big, like, dun-dun. Yeah. And, they, like, when they show the thing, and you're like, whoa, yeah, scary. But in this, they literally, like, they're just doing a panning shot, and he's just there. No music. He's hanging from a ceiling. Mm-hmm. And the xenomorph is just there, and you're like, holy shit, that's it.
Yeah. And you can totally, like, not even notice it, too.
Like, your heart just kind of sinks in that second.
Yeah,
yeah. It just hits you.
Yeah. Right. The realization, you know, I'm sure some people never, like, didn't even notice.
I can't even remember the character's name as he was looking for Jinxie.
Yeah, yeah. But then, yeah, when you do notice that's there, you're like, oh, fuck.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
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 It's just, like, a great fucking
What movie. Was the way they did it in the theatrical version?
It's when he jumps down to get the dude.
They didn't use that shot. No. Okay. Lame.
Yeah, but it's, like, it's very atmospheric. Mm-hmm. It's just a moody movie, and they do a really, really great job of building just all this tension.
Yeah.
And then one really big explosive thing happens really quick, and then it pulls back, and it's just tension again.
And you were right. We watched it not too long ago, and, like, you know, Sigourney Weaver is, you know, the main character of that movie, but you don't really realize it until it's, like, well into the movie.
Yep.
She's kind of like another person on the crew.
Yeah.
That she's just hanging out with all the people, and then eventually she becomes, like,
the
main person.
And it's really cool. Like, the whole movie, she's, like, the only character, like, you kind of realize there's something, like,
different about her.
About the character. She's the only one, like, following protocol to a T.
Right.
Like,
everyone else is too loosey-goosey.
When they wanted to get back in and everything, she was like, nope, nope. No. And
that obviously would have been the right move.
Yep.
But.
And I don't know. It's one of those, like we were talking about, it's one of those movies I can watch almost any time.
Yeah.
And be really into it.
I kind of want to watch it again. Maybe tonight.
Maybe tonight. It's a great fucking movie.
We'll see.
Let me give a pick. I won't give a reason. I'm just going
to
say.
All right. Mateo wants to say one.
Mateo in here.
And he's coming in and everything.
Okay.
He's going to make us all really mad.
The Departed.
The Departed.
Oh, okay. That's a great movie.
That's a good one.
I can agree with that.
All right. Back to Alejandro.
Okay.
Oh, boy.
I feel like every time Alejandro comes in, it's always going to be like, all right, guys, like, you're not going to agree with me here.
Wait, so.
Here you go. And then he drops something. We're like, oh, yeah.
Started off with.
Whiplash.
Yes. Right. Okay.
All right. So, number four on my list. Probably the reason why these kinds of movies can be taken seriously at all. The Dark Knight.
Okay.
Fantastic. Okay. Still the only superhero film that does not feel like a superhero film.
Right.
You know? It's
like
just
crime.
Real
drama.
Set in its own. Yeah, exactly.
Noir.
Yeah, yeah.
Noir.
It's nori and. It's just so good.
It is a great
The only bad thing that has come out of that movie is every superhero movie afterwards wanting to be dark and gritty.
Exactly.
That's the only bad, horrible thing.
Anything DC now, you know, is literally like, let's just grit off a Christopher Nolan train. And then they fail.
Yeah.
Because it's not Christopher Nolan.
It's not. Yeah, exactly. And that's the thing. He just has such a good balance at keeping the realism in there with the you know, real world lifestyle of what Gotham City would be.
I love how his take on that universe and how he tried to make that universe like a realistic
portrayal.
As realistic as possible.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
I love what he did there.
He integrates it well into the way that our society would kind of, you know, mesh with that sort of kind of concept.
So. I thought he did a great job of that.
Fantastic. Oh, yeah. Dark Knight was like, you could believe it. You could believe the crazy clown, you know, you could believe Two-Face, you know, each character had their own agenda more or less. And it's just, it sounds so silly. It's a thing. It sounds so stupid. Mm-hmm. But then the way he just delivered it was perfect.
You can actually take it seriously,
exactly.
Which is more than you can say for almost any of those movies that we listed off.
Yeah.
Trying to rip off of it.
Yeah. And I remember when The Dark Knight came out in theaters. I mean, it was a while ago, 2008. I just remember seeing the trailer for the first time and seeing the Joker for the first time.
And everyone bashed it. Everyone hated it so much, you know, me included. And then we were all wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone was so wrong with that Joker.
It's amazing how, as I was watching The Patriot not too long ago, which Heath Ledger is in.
Yeah, the younger son. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I was watching it, and I was just like, damn, like, he is a fucking great actor.
Yeah.
Like, what? He did, though, so, yeah. Now, he was a great actor. The range he had from doing the Joker to just watching him do The Patriot or, like, doing the like a Knight's Tale,
yeah, nice
or,
and,
you know,
jokey hat, like fun knight kind of guy,
and then doing the Joker, or even though he broke back a mountain,
oh yeah,
and the Joker is like, what, this guy
gay
is
cowboy,
fucking crazy,
yeah, soldier son,
yeah,
crazy mad clown guy,
but
know?
And you know,
like,
what, kind of annoys me is like the amount of people who believe that Heath Ledger like died because of his role as the Joker or whatever. Like he drove him to the edge.
Yeah, yeah.
To, which is insanity. Not which is not true at all.
Yeah. Well, it was death by drug overdose, right?
From some sort of like sleeping medication that he took too much of. He didn't kill himself on purpose, at least. As far as, you know.
I got to read the dosage. I want to see, because there's a difference between like 50 milligrams, like 200 milligrams, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, but it wasn't like the role.
It doesn't seem like it was intended.
The role drove him crazy. Like people were like, oh, he was, and he didn't like stay completely in character. Like,
during the whole scene,
he did not like people. Oh, he was always the Joker. That's what made him. Like people just like to sensationalize that story
as a thing.
It's not true. So
poor guy, though. Honestly, it sucks that he died before the film came out.
True.
He would have had such a huge ride to success. You know, further.
All right, guys.
What was that?
An Oscar.
If he was alive.
Probably. I mean, he probably would have gotten at least nominated.
No, I mean, he did win.
Oh, he won?
Yeah, he won a post-mortem Oscar for Best Supporting Actor. Mm-hmm. Do you guys think if he didn't die, he still would have won that Oscar?
Yeah.
I think so.
I think he deserved it, definitely.
Yeah. That role, like, blew everyone away. Yeah. No one expected it. No one expected something insanely talented as he portrayed the Joker. But, like, so different from our concept as well. We hadn't, we've never seen something like that. We've never seen that character act as dark as that, you know? Because the Joker's kind of fun, let's be honest here. He's just fun in a twisted kind of way.
But it was like actually like
dark and he
kind of scary when he was on screen.
Oh, dude, I love the scene in the beginning when he takes off the mask.
Oh, yeah, yep.
And you see that extreme close-up of his face, and then the music cue is just like, duh, just like drops. Yeah. You see his face. It's like such a cool introduction to the character.
The character, yeah.
All right,
what's moving on.
My next one is I want to hide it.
I know, right? You just don't want to be like, no one goes to
Okay. All right, I'll go with this one. I was like, all right, I gotta put a Spielberg flick on there.
Okay. Oh, that's fair.
Because I love Spielberg. So of all the ones that I'm a fan of, I decided to go with Jurassic Park.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, man. I just think it was close. Like Raiders, like was close, but Jurassic Park, I think, is like a better made movie than Raiders of the Lost Ark.
I think that
the fucking stupid.
Yo,
you want to go?
No. Raiders of the Lost Ark is one of like the greats.
It is.
Jurassic Park is Jurassic Park.
Yo,
Mateo's sitting over there on the fucking couch roasting my picks.
No. This is his picks.
No. I wouldn't.
You have no reign.
I was fine with it until you toss shade at Raiders.
I didn't toss shade at Raiders. I love Raiders.
He picked one or the other. It's fine. It's fair. It happens.
Yo, are you sitting over here?
Oh, in front of the camera? No, I can see. See, I'm
on Carl's page. I think Jurassic
I am too. I think Jurassic Park is a better made movie than Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Genuinely more fun, I think, in its own kind of way.
Now,
like, this guy.
I watched Raiders this morning.
Oh, did you?
Actually, yes. And it is definitely on my top 10.
Oh, of course.
And it's almost perfection. But I don't know. I just gave the edge to Jurassic Park just because. I don't know. It was more of a gut thing, I guess.
Hmm.
You can feel it.
You know what Raiders doesn't have?
Hmm.
Jeff Goldblum.
That's true. Yeah.
But
that's my man.
Raiders does have Harrison Ford, so.
That's true.
Who's better than Jeff Goldblum? But Harrison Ford is way better than Jeff Goldblum.
He is, but I don't like saying it because Harrison Ford's kind of a douche, but you know what I mean?
He's not a douche.
He's a little bit of a douche.
Come on.
You've seen it. Do you guys remember when he had like the Lego thing
that and
he just
funny.
Fucking breaks it?
That guy's face was just scripted.
You could see it.
There's no way he would do
recently,
that.
During the celebration, they asked him, they were like, oh, are you excited to see, your character this. Played by someone else? He was like, no.
Okay, hey, now you're taking stuff out of context here, okay? I saw that. They asked him, are you excited for the Han Solo movie? And he laughed, he said, not really. And everyone laughed, and he was like, no, in all seriousness, he was like, I am excited to see, He did say that, he said it right after.
I think he's still... Like, gut thing, his first answer was the truer one.
I agree. But he you can't expect... He doesn't give a shit about, like, like Star Wars that much, but he has shown that he came to Celebration in the first place.
That is true. That is true.
And I watched, you know, all the stuff that he was on, I watched, and he was very like grateful to be there.
I'm not taking away from his cool factor.
He's a
cool guy. I'm not saying that. He's a great actor.
I wouldn't say he's a douche though.
I'm not taking away from his acting.
He's a little. He's a little douche.
He's off-putting, is what it is.
Yeah.
I think you're a bitch.
I think he's very full of himself.
I don't think he is. I think he's an old man. He has done a lot of great films.
Maybe you got some of them rose-tinted glasses.
No,
looking back
no,
at those roles.
No, no. I think
Carl sees himself in Harrison Ford.
I wish. No, I just think people like take things too seriously, and I think that they expect him to be a certain way.
Hmm.
You know, they expect him to be like the perfect like celebrity that people want him to be, and be like, mm-hmm. oh yeah, he's just a dude, a guy.
I'd expect him to be act a little bit more like Mark Hamill does. I mean, Mark Hamill obviously isn't like all in with Star Wars and stuff like that, but he's kind of goofing around. He's with it,
but they're different people.
But I'm saying like,
but Harrison Ford could benefit from being.
You
don't
know what I'm talking about. He's just being.
Yeah.
I don't think he's not douchey. I just think that he get out of here. I just think that people expect him to be a certain way, and I don't think that's fair.
It's okay.
To expect the
person. Anyway, Jurassic Park, great fucking movie. Yeah.
But yeah, Jurassic Park, I fucking love it, and it's one of those movies. Yeah, one of those movies that I just. Will pop in whenever, anytime, and watch all of it. And the fucking animatronics on that movie—they're
great,
so good. The T-Rex in Jurassic Park looks way better, in my opinion, than the T-Rex in Jurassic World.
Yes,
right.
The T-Rex in Jurassic Park looks way better than that fucking voodoo scene at the end of Raiders of the Lost Ark, let me tell you.
That's true, it does.
I said I seen that T-Rex in real life.
But no, I did.
ILM offices.
Oh, right. Yeah. I watched Raiders this morning, and yeah, at the end, the whole, like, the arc opening up and everything, it looks super cheesy for the most part. Yeah. Like, the melting faces looks amazing.
Oh,
but,
yeah, that's
but, like, good. All like, the ghosties and stuff flying around, I was like, ah, lol. But Jurassic Park, you know, a lot of those animatronics and, like, the suits, the Velociraptor suits that the people were in.
Great. Fantastic.
Dope.
Yep.
Looks so good.
I agree.
Yeah. Thank you.
I do.
And then, of course, you know, Jeff Goldblum shirtless.
Amazing.
Just like,
oh, man, posed. What a sexy dude.
He's very sexy. Very sexy.
All right. Talking about Harrison Ford, Empire Strikes the Fuck Back, son.
We knew he was coming sometime.
Gotta get it out of the way. That movie, is it on yours?
It is on
mine. I knew that was going to be our big overlap.
Yes. That's about Empire. Okay.
So... The Empire Strikes Back is, like, one of those movies, I think it was, like, the first movie that I saw as a youth and was like, that's a really good movie.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I could actually pinpoint, like, this is a high-quality film, not high just, quality. Like, a movie I like.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's starts out. Let's just go the whole rundown of the Empire Strikes Back and talk about how good each scene is. Yeah.
Starts out. Fucking Star Destroyer sends in some probes onto Hoth.
Yeah.
They land on Hoth. Then we see Luke and Han Solo.
Oh, he's there. They were right.
They were right.
Sending out some probes.
On Hoth. Riding Tauntauns in the middle of a blizzard.
Yeah. I mean, it's just like that movie start to finish is good.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, the whole thing with making Darth Vader like a real character and a real villain with nuances and like a motive.
Yeah.
Like in the first one in Star Wars, I'm not going to call it by its new surname, in Star Wars.
Yes.
Star Wars.
He's just kind of a villain.
Mm.
Yeah.
He's brooding. Yeah. He's scary, but he's just kind
doesn't
of
doesn't have any sort of story to him.
No.
And he doesn't have a whole lot of screen time in the first one as much as, you know, Empire. But.
And I still think it's a little silly putting him in a TIE fighter, but that's beside the point.
Okay.
Empire Strikes
TIE,
Back.
Interceptor?
Probably. TIE Interceptor. Ever. God. Nerd. Take off your pants, find a calculator down there, nerd. Anyway. But Darth Vader mm-hmm. in this movie is just so brooding right. and so scary.
Yeah, and you're right. The whole the added like motive that he has Empire Strikes Back is super just it makes him a little scarier. Yeah, because in the opening crawl they describe him as being obsessed with finding Luke Skywalker.
Yeah,
and that's his entire game plan, the entire movie. Everything mm-hmm. he does is based around that goal.
Getting closer. Yeah,
yeah.
And then like and then. Okay, we. Of course, as a culture, have that line ingrained in our heads.
Yep.
But can we recognize what a fucking turnaround that is?
Yeah. And you talk to anyone who was like old enough to see that movie and experience that series when it first came out. Talk to anyone, they'll say, yeah, that twist was like
blew everyone's mind. Yep. Yeah, yeah. One of the first huge plot twists in cinema as far as like. Action adventure goes.
You know? Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I love, like, you can go on YouTube and watch, like, kids like, reacting to that.
Yeah, reacting. Yeah.
It's very funny. It like, is. You see yeah. these kids are like.
So, talking about kids and not knowing shit, fucking yeah. Tyler saw Revenge of the Sith, and he did, the entire time he didn't know that Anakin was Darth Vader until the moment Palpatine like
called him Darth Vader. Vader. Yes,
it's true. Like, at the end of, near the end of the movie, and Tyler was like,
I was like, what? Like,
he's Darth Vader.
That's crazy. I watch all these movies and he's Darth Vader. Oh my God. Like,
oh my God.
And, you know, but bringing it back.
How'd you know that?
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. Shut up. I don't know. Anyway. Anyway,
theatrical posters even showed like little Anakin with Darth Vader's shadow. You know,
I wasn't thinking like that.
It was like straight as like oh God, here's the origin stories, and yeah. it's in your face this whole time. I mean, honestly, you had the best experience then.
Yeah, true.
I did have a great experience yes. when you said I was like,
you're a fucking like moron.
Moving anyway, on from this
yes, Empire, but a lot of people might. I think the. But of all the Star Wars movies, the ones that people see the most are either the original or Empire.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Of being the best.
Yeah.
Of
yeah.
all of them. And I give the edge to Empire because people are like, oh, well, the first one, that's not Star Wars at all. But I was like, yeah.
That's it's so
not,
slow.
That's not that a,
doesn't mean anything.
It's not slow. Get out of here. But that's not a reason. That's not a reason for it to be better. Just it was the first one, you know? I think that Empire basically just like.
Has all the qualities that right. the first one had, but like.
More.
Yes. Better. Like threefold.
Made the characters so much more like mm-hmm. funny and yeah. interesting. And like, even though Han and Leia and Chewie all. And no, not Ben. Ben's dead.
Ben's dead.
But they all go on their separate adventure. And right. even though it's not like super mega important.
They're getting chased by the Empire. It's still. It's cool.
It's still fun to
it's
watch.
It's exciting. Yeah. Seeing the Falcon being chased by, you know, TIE fighters,
yeah, dude.
Darth Vader going after him, the going into the asteroid and the worm.
Yep.
And the Luke's training with Yoda.
Yeah.
We get introduced to Yoda.
Oh yeah. Man.
Damn.
Yoda, what a character.
Mine.
Also the movie is just a better made film than the first one.
Absolutely.
They had more money, they had more, you know, stuff to do.
The lightsaber fight is so
choice.
Good.
Choice.
That's so good. Oh man. So man, there's like there's so many like really really crazy shots of Vader.
Oh, in, there's so many in good that shots fight. Of Vader.
Like there's that one when like all the stuff's flying at him and he's just like waving his lightsaber around. And
my
like,
favorite shot in the entire movie is gotta be when Luke goes up and goes into the carbonite room, freezing mm-hmm, room, mm-hmm. and like he sees Vader, mm-hmm. and Vader's standing on the staircase,
oh.
and all you see is like the blue and orange glow, like the mist. And Vader's just like black silhouette. And it's all quiet. And he's just, oh,
it's so
dude,
good.
Standing there, man. Yeah.
And, yeah, I mean, there's so much you could say about that fight.
Yeah.
There's so, like, when Vader is just standing there, like, tossing stuff at him.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's not doing, like, big stuff like we see later. Like, yeah. he's yeah. just kind of like.
And Luke's just like.
Yeah, yeah, getting fucked by it.
I love, there's a moment in the fight where Vader's just like, fuck this shit. And then like, it's near, close to when they get on that thing where he cuts his hand off.
Yeah.
And, like, Luke is going down the hallway, and then Vader's, like, hiding. And then he just comes out of the, he's like.
Oh, yeah.
And then Vader's just, like putting everything he can into each swing. And he's yeah. just, like, two-handed it, yeah. you know, as a, fine.
Like a vicious but, Sith would.
But also, just the fact that, you know, I love how it ends. You know, Luke has his hand cut off. He finds out that Vader's his father. Han gets frozen in carbonite. Like, it ends
that
off.
That scene, man. Oof.
You know,
it ends off everybody's bad off.
Yes. Not good. Yes. Not good. Yeah.
like almost defeated.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
you know, it's tough to come back from that.
Yeah,
I don't know. Like I get overwhelmed.
Yeah.
when I think about how good that movie
and,
is.
Yeah, you look at some of the most iconic lines of Star Wars are in that film. Mm-hmm. You know, the "I love you, I know."
Oh yeah,
Lang is fucking genius. It's perfect.
It's a great movie.
Is that genius?
Yes, it is genius.
It's a great movie, Mateo.
For,
get your fucking Woody Harrelson ass out.
Woody Harrelson.
1970.
Woody Harrelson.
Woody Allen.
It's a joke. Woody Harrelson.
Oh, okay.
I always thought that line was just kind of cheesy.
You're kind of cheesy. Fuck you, Mateo. Anyways. Alejandro. Hey,
number three.
We don't care about Mateo's opinion here because he's not on the...
Number three.
Alejandro?
I'm sorry.
Oh, Alejandro, go ahead, Alejandro. Number, go ahead, Alejandro. Go ahead.
Mateo, you have to learn you can't talk shit on any Star Wars
Star
film,
Wars.
Especially around Carl.
Hey, Alejandro?
American Beauty.
America. Oh, I didn't see that one coming.
You didn't see it coming. You know why?
Why is that?
Because I'm fucking cultured and you got nothing.
I'm fucking cultured.
I'm kidding. No, American Beauty. One of those movies that... Obviously, I had a lot of accolades, awards, you know, a lot of
accolades.
Yeah,
I never saw it. I heard it's like really messed up.
And that's the thing; like, I didn't know what I was expecting out of it. I thought I was gonna be a creepy dude, creepy dad, going for some teenage pussy.
It is pretty creepy.
Yes, teenage
pussy.
But it's everything else in that movie that's just like,
yeah.
Put it on one day, you know, not knowing what I was gonna get myself into, much like Whiplash, and came out like that was fantastic. That was just like one hell of a solid movie.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because really the beauty of it's a guy who like realizes like, why can't I sleep with her?
Yeah,
why can't I do that?
Yeah.
You know what? Why am I working a dead end job? Why do I live with a wife who hates me?
Yeah,
why? You know, and he just doesn't give a shit anymore, and he just does whatever the fuck he wants.
But you know what I love is I love all that, and also I love it at the end. When he's about to have sex with her, and she's like, "I'm a virgin," right? And then he's like, "It kind of like it brings him back to reality."
Yeah,
and
he's like, he just snaps into it,
and he's like, "We're not doing this." Puts clothes on her, and then he's like, finally looks happy at the first time in his life.
Yeah, exactly.
He's like, "I'm good."
And doesn't that just like make that whole package just so uniform and complete?
Yeah,
you know,
because if he like had sex with her, I'd be like,
okay, then you lose like your like for this character. You lose what makes him so human to you.
Yeah,
you know?
But at the end when he had it, and then he was like, I'm good.
That clarity, and he feels happy for once in his life.
Yep,
for the first time.
And then
time
he dies.
Time. Don't spoil it. I wanted her to watch it.
Oh, okay. Sorry, he dies.
Well, he's dead. So you don't have to watch that movie. You can cross that one off the list.
But
you
know
appease Alejandro.
How he dies.
You don't even know why.
Tell us. Do it. Drop it.
I mean, does it matter?
No,
he dies.
I'm sorry.
It does matter.
Anyways,
it does matter.
Anyway.
I'm sorry, Vern.
Anyway.
I spoiled the movie.
Anyways,
it came out a long time.
But so, like, I wanted him to see it too. Either way, it's a great movie. I think it's on a lot of lists as well for, you know, top choices, top 100, you know, stuff like that. I think it's fantastic. It's really well done. And, you know, Kevin Spacey.
Mm.
He's the fucking man.
He's so good in that movie, man.
I think he's a great actor all to begin with, but, like, that movie sells it for me, you know.
And we got a lot of, like, shirtless
scenes.
Kevin Spacey in there working out.
Yeah.
Some sweaty muscles.
It's the dad bod who's like, you know what? Yeah, we're not making... We're going to go for, like, a dad bod.
Yeah.
More from dad bod to daddy bod.
There you go.
Oh, shit.
There you go.
Yeah.
Anyway.
But also the the whole like subplot with the dad of that kid.
The
gay stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that was
that's a whole other story, man.
It's a whole other thing.
Like when that happened, I was like,
and then you're like, oh, it makes sense.
Everything makes sense.
Yeah,
because the life of him makes sense.
The one thing that
life makes sense.
Right,
poor woman.
The one thing in that movie that I was just like, this is stupid, was this how the kid, the edgy like son of the guy was like had that video of the bag.
Oh yeah, which makes no sense. He's like,
it's
so beautiful.
Beautiful. And it was just like a plastic bag like
flying
around
in the air. Yeah.
And I was like, that's all right. It's a little lame. But movie's great. Yeah. All right, back to me.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Empire was on my list, so we talked about Empire.
Yeah, we did that.
So that
you
was...
should, if there's one on there that you think I picked.
Okay.
I
think there is. Yeah. Okay. I did Jurassic Park, 12 Angry Men.
So that we can even
Empire,
it out.
Pulp Fiction.
Pulp Fiction is also on my list.
So I'll start off with saying this. Pulp Fiction is a movie where, like, so many people say it's like one of the best movies ever made. Like, one of the best movies ever. They put it on a lot of, like, you know, greatest movie lists.
We have to, like, address the fact that it is mega basic to pick this movie.
It is.
It is, like,
people, oh, Pulp Fiction.
First movie ever. And now we're at this point of people, like, trying to use it as, like, they're like, I'm really deep in cinema, so I watch Quentin Tarantino. Yeah. Like, it's become, like, a mega meme.
Yeah, yeah.
So we have to recognize that.
Addressing
but
that.
Pulp Fiction is a fantastic movie.
All those
you can't let the memes, dilute the fact that it is fucking awesome.
It deserves like all of that like attention.
Have you not seen it or didn't like it?
Okay, we've had this discussion. I didn't like it my first time. Was just like, what the fuck is this? Okay,
yeah.
And then like one day at the bar with Vern, mm-hmm. it's just on TV, mm-hmm. and I got absorbed. And I was like, oh shit, this is really good. Yeah. All right, there you go. I liked it. All right.
Okay.
It's on my list. Sorry. I liked
it. See, okay, there are like other Tarantino movies that like I feel are like better written than Pulp Fiction.
Yeah.
And that is Tarantino's thing is being this zany writer.
The only movie I was close to putting was Inglourious Bastards.
I love that movie.
Yeah.
Love it. That opening scene.
I watched Hateful Eight again.
Mm-hmm.
Recently, I liked it more the second time. I was more into the writing this time around.
Word.
But because I knew what I was in for, it was just a Tarantino masturbatory fest.
Yes, like writing like.
Yeah, exactly. Pulp Fiction.
Pulp Fiction though is like, it's one of those movies where you know some time passes from seeing it, and I'm like, oh, I don't know if it
sticks.
If it's still good anymore.
If it lives up to the hype still, and I'll put it in. And I'll be like. Man, fucking lives up to the hype. It has aged very well.
Yep,
and the
like
writing,
a fine wine, like a good aged cheese.
The writing is razor sharp, and I just love. It's a very. I love how it's not super heavy. You know, like I love Inglourious Basterds, but generally I'll go with a less heavier thing than something else. Just the way I am. So I love Inglourious Basterds, but I'm more likely to pop in Pulp Fiction because it's a more of a light watch.
It is.
Compared to that. Inglourious Basterds has like heavy drama and like Holocaust stuff. And
it gets heavy.
It's dark.
So, but Pulp Fiction, it is a ton of violence.
Just crime.
But it's just like crime. It's fun.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Very fun.
Yeah, it's a fun as hell movie.
Almost jokey. Campy.
Yeah, there's rape in it, but it's like not like...
But they like kind of like make a joke about it. It's very weird.
Because, you know, Marcellus Wallace is like big gangster who's like fucking feared by everybody. He's getting raped in the butt. Bruce Willis saves him with a katana.
It's great.
Like, it's so cool.
Oh, right. Okay.
It's so cool.
I was trying to remember that.
Okay. I love that.
Yo, you want that gun? Don't just say it. Daddy boy.
But I just love how like the movie just isn't really about anything. It just is like things happening. You know?
Well, yeah, I mean, that's if you look at the title,
yeah,
Pulp Fiction. That's what it is. It is. Yeah,
it's just stuff happening. This doesn't have like really a plot, it's
a real concise story. It does, but
it doesn't like end.
Yeah,
like, it doesn't have an ending.
It's just like, but it doesn't, but also has like the last scene does have some sort of closure to it, you know, with like
jewels. Weirdly, even though that scene happens like kind of in the middle of the movie or like, somewhere
like,
in there.
I was looking at this thing, it was like this, like chronological order of the movie, mm-hmm, and the last scene of like everything is the scene where Butch and his girl, I forget her name,
when they ride off
on the
Zed's dead, baby. Zed's dead.
Zed's chopper.
Yeah,
that's like the last thing that happens.
You know what is like one of the best fucking scenes in that movie is when John Travolta shoots Marvin in the face. And they have to deal with it.
Yeah.
It's so good.
Yeah. Oh, man, I shot Marvin in the face. Why the fuck you do that?
I didn't mean to.
that shit was fucking hilarious. That scene, I love the scene where Butch saves Marcellus with the katana. Yep. I love that because just minutes ago they were like fighting. They're trying to kill each other. And now Bruce has his way out.
Mm-hmm.
And then he hears him getting raped in the basement.
Yeah.
And then he's like... I can't leave him like this.
Yeah.
So cool.
And that great scene where you just see Butch's face for a really long time while they're playing Al Green as it zooms out.
Yeah,
and he just has that like shit-eating kind of look on his face. He's like,
And Marcellus is
talking to him about losing the fight and everything. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
fuck pride. Yeah. Pulp Fiction.
The movie's great. All right.
All right. Nice choice, fellas.
We talked about it enough. My next choice is Spirited Away.
Oh, it's a nice one.
My favorite
animated film.
Animated film. Okay. Yeah. I didn't pick an animated film. All right.
Well. Yeah. and again, like I said with Pulp Fiction, it's super basic to pick that over the other Miyazaki films.
I love anime. I watch Spirited Away. Like, you know.
But... Right. Spirited Away is like
it's good for a reason. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. It's reached its and my story with it is pretty funny. Mm. I was in a class in high school. I went to kind of a rougher high school. I'm not gonna tell you which
rougher,
but all the people in my class were very loud. In this, it was a film appreciation class. Mm. Okay, and it's basically a bullshit class where everyone just goes to watch a movie, and like we have to do like a review, like a mock analysis, review for it. But the students could pick the movies and stuff. One kid picked Friday. And we played it for like all of 2 minutes and the teacher was like, nope, we can't watch this.
He didn't even know.
Like... Yeah, he'd never heard of Friday. But anyway, this like the super dorky, you know, anime kid in my class. There's always an anime kid in your class.
There's always one. At least one.
That one really stinky kid.
Oh. That was him.
That was. It was kind of his turn to pick what movie we watch. He picks, of course, some anime film. And I'm like, here we go.
Here we go.
And so.
Was everyone else like kind of like
and
that?
Everybody's like, oh my God, it's David's turn to pick. He brings in Spirited Away and like everybody's like, oh my God, we're all just going to bullshit this class. It goes on. Class is silent. And we're all like everybody is into like, it. 100% of the class, the teacher, everybody's involved.
Damn.
There was an applause at the end of the movie.
Yo, wow.
And we were like
that was a good movie.
The teacher got up and he's like this very like 50s kind of like just walked out of the jazz club kind of guy. Yeah. And he's like, that was a damn good movie, I'll tell you. And it is. I mean, the art in it, the central themes of it. It's just like, it is a very artistic kind of masterpiece.
Yeah. No, masterpiece is definitely the best way to describe it.
I haven't seen it since I was a kid. So it's been such a long time. Most Miyazaki films go right over my head, honestly.
What?
Right over your head. What do you mean?
Like, I've only seen so many, like Howl's Moving Castle,
so upset right
Ponyo,
now.
Steer World of Arietti.
Wait, Vern, keep that face, good. Please.
I want to see a few more, and that's one that I should go back and watch.
It's very good.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like it is, and I just, of course.
I came close to picking out of the Miyazaki films, Howl's Moving Castle.
Which is a great one as well.
But I decided, it was another gut thing.
Yeah. The personal, yeah, I haven't seen that one. So you recommend me, like, that's
the,
like.
Absolutely, it's the next one.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, next one I get, I'll get that.
It's a good one.
Yeah.
It's a good one.
Word.
Because Carl does this thing with Miyazaki films because they're so expensive.
Yeah.
He like buys one like every few months.
Yeah. Right. Which is fair. It's fair. You know? And you got them on the Blu-ray.
Yeah.
The Blu-ray.
And
but yeah, Spirited Away.
Spirited Away.
I mean, it goes really well with like a lot of the Japanese folklore and stuff. It actually stays true to some of that. Yeah. And it's just an interesting watch.
So many really like just fun and like cool, like spirits and ghosties and stuff like that. It's just so cool. Yeah.
And the whole thing with No Face.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Like the whole, how that, I mean, it is really, are you making that face for a reason? Okay, I thought you were like pertaining to the discussion. It's a really gross scene when he's like eating all the food. Yeah. But there's like such a huge lesson in that, and like it's very very symbolic.
Symbolic.
Symbiosis.
All right, so we're going back to
Before I say anything else, are your guys lists done then?
I have one more.
You have one
more?
I think
you should have one more, right? Or no?
Let me check. I'm almost done.
You have one more?
Yeah, I have one more.
Okay.
Okay, because I have two more.
Oh, because we have some.
But I will say my last two in this one, so we can just
so nice just and clean. Wrap it up.
Mm-hmm. Right. Very clean and easy. I'm going to. This is a difficult choice in my head between like which one I like more than the other. Because I like them both for very different reasons. Mm. But I'll say them both, and we'll see which ones you guys like to pick out of them. Number one of this list, of course, there will be blood.
Ah, okay.
No. Okay, so I...
All right, listen, I was like, no one? No one?
Okay. I was going to watch that movie.
And you never have. Is that what you're saying?
I was about to pop it on Netflix. I said something to Carl about it. I was like, I think I want to watch this movie, There Will Be Blood. He was like, that movie is so boring. Don't watch it.
Don't roast me.
I'm not roasting you. This isn't a roast. It's like, because...
Get out of here.
Fucking
exhilarating.
I love that movie.
That movie is so absorbing.
He was so fucking sick.
It's so good.
Listen, listen.
In fairness, I saw it when I was younger.
That's fair.
I saw it when I was eight.
Good for you. Get out of here.
All right. Thank you, Mateo. I appreciate it.
No, anyway,
no need to defend.
Guys, I didn't mean to start this. All I'm saying is that, like, it's, I can tell everything I've seen, it's like a very, like, cinema-y film. Like when he said that, when he described it that way, I was like, I'm not really feeling that right now.
Okay, let's put it this way. Next time you're down for a serious movie, that's a serious movie. Yes, I think I truly believe, just because
I read the description, the synopsis of the movie, and it was talking about like oil refineries and stuff, and I was like, I don't know, that sounds...
And really the plot's almost that simple, but it's one of those, I love the character development. That's my thing. I don't want a good plot. I want characters who feel real and have this great amount of growth, you know, throughout a film, you know. That's what I enjoy. That's why the movie you're talking about, the 12
Angry Men.
Yeah. That sounds amazing, because it's all about those characters in that courtroom and how much they grow as people throughout the adventure. Mm-hmm. And that's to be said about There Will Be Blood. It's one of those films that doesn't have like a true definitive ending, but you just get so much out of it, you know. And that's just me. You guys may be different. You guys not may get the same exact sort of appeal that I got out of it, you know. Right. But that's something I love about it. And, you know, it was between that and not the second choice, but like I was thinking, like, there's one of these two heavy movies that I want to add to this list. It was that or No Country for Old Men.
Right.
I think
No Country for Old Men is a great fucking movie.
Wait, is that on your list or was that? No, that's not.
That was between that and That Will Be Blood.
I saw, like I said to you before, I saw No Country for Old Men like 2 or 3 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember like just right when it ended, I was like, holy fuck. Like right when I was like, that's like...
Now,
top 20 at least.
Take that, and for me, it was multiply that feeling by like 5, okay. And that was
There Will Be Blood.
Yes, to me,
okay.
It's a longer experience. Mm-hmm. I think it's probably about
like 3 hours.
I think it's like 240 some, I believe, but it's only like 20 or 30 minutes longer than No Country, if I'm correct. I could be very, very wrong there. Correct me, viewers.
I don't know the name of the villain and the actor who played in No Country for Old Men.
Javier Bardem.
Bardem, yeah. Oh yeah, he's. Salazar.
Captain Salazar.
But his performance in that movie was just like mind blowing.
And that's my way of feeling for
it's so good. It's disgusting how good that role
is.
That's how I think about Daniel Day-Lewis, you know, playing his character in There Will Be Blood.
Oh yeah.
Because it really, honestly, he's sort of the villain throughout the entire movie. That's something that film does very well. The main character that you're following is truly the villain, you know?
Okay.
But you're watching it through the whole way, and it's... Oh,
I should just watch it, what you're saying here.
All right. Yes.
And
my last pick, The Big Short.
Okay, cool.
Probably one of the most fun movies I've ever seen while introducing such a stupid topic. Mm-hmm. All right.
Like, I watched that like a few weeks ago.
And did you like
first
it?
First time. I loved it a lot.
It's great, right?
It's very entertaining.
That's the thing. Like, it's a movie talking about, it knows what it's talking about. It knows that it's like, you don't care about this fucking banking bullshit. You don't care about the whole financial crisis. You don't know the whole numbers, the triple A's and the B's and the double ratings and all this stuff.
I love the first thing it does, where it does those weird cutaways.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, here's Margot Robbie in a bathtub to explain this.
Margot Robbie, the bonding thing.
So I like that they did that kind of shit. It was cool.
And that's what's so fun about the movie. It takes such a dumb, not dumb, all right, rather such a monotonous topic, something that's so boring. And you wouldn't expect to like watch this, and you think more documentary, you know, you think more like business suit guy talking about the financial crisis of 2007, and you get this like almost like this like coked up sort of fun, energetic party movie. Right. That's
and it was like pretty much following three different
storylines.
Yeah, the Christian Bale thing. We had the two young guys,
the two friends. Yeah,
the Steve Carell one with
and his team.
Ryan Gosling.
Yeah.
So which of those three did you enjoy the most? Those three storylines.
That's tough. I guess I could say that Christian Bale is my least favorite because there's only that his has the most subtext to it. His has the most information that follows.
I wanted more out of his character, but every scene was just him in the office.
Mm-hmm, pretty much,
he never left the office. So
that honestly was his life in real life too. Yeah. That was more or less how his story went along. He knew what he was doing the whole time, but he just got shit from his bosses.
Yeah,
and then he left the what's it called? That sort of job, whatever they do there.
Yeah.
Yeah, he left that whole field and started working on other things, which is that, but you know, that's the simple story. But like I said, that has the most subtext because he knew what he was talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone else was like, we think we know.
Right. He was the only one who was like,
definite.
This is happening.
But like, he saw that we were getting fucked over as a nation.
Yeah.
And the other guys were all just like, was he right? Is he wrong? Like, what's going on? Like, this doesn't make sense.
They're trying to figure it out. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's why their sides of the stories are more fun.
Mm-hmm.
I think
Carell is so good.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He's a character who you watch The Office and you're like, how's he going to be, he's kind of like a hard ass,
that's the thing. I saw him before I got into The Office. I saw The Way Back where he was like a total dickhead.
Yeah.
And remember we saw it at, when we were in Cape Cod.
Yeah, we did. Yeah.
Yeah. And, he was just a total asshole in that movie. And I was like, oh, wow. He's an actor. Like, he can actually do this. Yeah.
He that one scene in the movie where they're at like that conference thing, and Steve Carell like stands up and he like calls out the dude.
Zero.
Yeah, zero. And then he like answers the phone call.
Yeah.
And he walks out.
I gotta take this.
And then Ryan Reynolds looks at the camera.
You must be from Bank of America.
Oh yeah. And Ryan Reynolds looks at the camera and he's like,
Ryan Gosling.
That actually happened. Or Ryan Gosling. He's like, that actually happened. Mark Baum, he did that. He took the call. He walked out. That happened.
Do you see what I'm dealing with here?
Like, that's
funny. So great. That's why that movie is so fun. Like, it knows what it's doing, what it wants to be, and it's so smart and tongue in cheek. Mm-hmm. And
see, I felt a similar way about like the way you're describing like something that seems kind of boring, but then they make it kind of a big party, more fun movie. Is Wolf of Wall Street?
Yes.
You guys keep talking. I have to hop off really quick.
You what?
I'll be right back.
Okay.
Is that a pick or no?
No, it's not. What I was saying is like, is it kind of like that?
Yes and no. Yes, in the sense that it's very high energy.
Right.
No, in the sense that Wolf of Wall Street, they are literally doing cocaine, drugs.
Yeah.
Doing like as much crazy shit as possible. What I'm saying is that The Big Short takes the same form of like energy values. Like it wants to.
Is it more of a movie? Because that was
by far. There's a very very concrete story, and like he said, it's described in three different plot lines based on three different characters or character stories. One, Steve Carell and his group, his folks, with Ryan Gosling helping them. The two friends who are little yuppies who like land on gold, basically.
Yuppies,
and they hang out with
Brad Pitt.
Brad Pitt, yes. Yeah. And Brad Pitt's character also fantastic. Yeah. I did not see him playing some really stern old guy.
Smaller role, but definitely
very well done. Yeah. And then you have Christian Bale's side of the story too, and it's all about what happened leading up to the financial crisis of 2007 and how these guys shorted the banking loans and basically made triple, quadruple,
bet against it.
Yes,
the housing market and stuff. Hmm. And I liked how they were like, the two younger guys. They were like really jazzed that it was happening.
Mm-hmm,
and getting all this money. And Brad Pitt's like, you guys, you
realize like what this is going to do in the American economy.
And they were like, oh yeah.
But that's what I'm saying. It matches the energy of Wolf of Wall Street without having to force drugs and sex and coke and
be like a little just too much.
Exactly. And that's what I love so much about The Big Short,
which leads me to a shout out. Goodfellas is better than Wolf of Wall Street, and it was going to be on my top five.
Nobody ever would argue that.
I've had that argument. I've had it.
Well, they're just fucking 100%.
He's saying that this argument hasn't existed. It exists.
Yeah.
Yeah, with idiots.
Okay. But Goodfellas, it was going to be. It's like right under my top.
Okay.
It's like my number six.
Yeah, Wolf of Wall Street is Wolf of Wall Street is enjoyable, but it's pretty overrated.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. Anyway.
To you. My final pick is it's gonna be Fellowship of the Ring.
I almost put a Lord of the Rings on there, but I looked at them and I was like,
you need something a little bit more.
Because if I want to pick the Lord of the Rings, I want to pick the whole thing. I want to pick the trilogy.
Pick one movie,
but yeah. I can't do that. And I was like, you know what, Lord of the Rings, I'm just gonna put it because like Empire is such a like this is a standout great fucking movie.
Right.
With the Lord of the Rings trilogy, it to me is like they're all kind of a similar quality.
Think wrong.
I know you think Fellowship is like such a great, I don't know. Fellowship bores me sometimes.
Fellowship is, at least in my opinion, I think it's the best of the trilogy. It's the tightest movie of the three. It has the most clear just plot directive and just like direction. Yeah. Two Towers is the one that bores me the most.
Okay, you're right. It's very, yes, very drawn out. 100%. Yeah. You are right. Yeah. But thank you. You know me in Return of the King.
Return of the King. I used to like Return of the King more as the most, but then watching Fellowship, I was like, you know what? Fellowship?
Look, man, it's in those extended scenes of Return of the King. Mm. Some of my favorites. You know me in the Mouth of Sauron. Right, that's one of my favorite scenes in the whole
Sauron is cool.
Whole thing.
I mean, he lasts for like 30 seconds. Dude,
when Aragorn just fucking cuts his head off and he's like, I do not believe it. I will not.
He's jolly.
Wait, what?
Fellowship
is jolly. So jolly. It's jolly. I will give you that. But like, dude, like Return of the King is like almost a war movie. I mean, at a certain point.
Yeah, I mean, it's a war movie. I mean,
and it's like one of the best war movies ever fucking crafted.
Yeah, the battle scenes are. Way to hijack my pick with talking about how good Return of the King is.
I'm just saying.
No, I agree.
I'm just saying.
The battle scenes are fucking great, but I like Fellowship the most because, it does have that super jolly beginning at the Shire. I love the Shire. I love seeing.
I agree with you guys. I love
seeing the world of the Hobbits. And I love the adventure that Frodo was sent on. And also, the Fellowship is so fucking dope.
Right.
The Fellowship is rad as balls.
It is pretty rad.
Once they are sent out into the world, it's so cool.
And that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying is that, like, I couldn't pick Return over them. Like, when I thought about it, and I was like, I only like Return marginally more than Fellowship.
Okay, yeah.
But I couldn't
pick it. It wasn't enough to...
Yeah, it wasn't
enough. Yeah. But, like... And I just, once they send out, the Fellowship is out there, it's so cool, and I love all of the individual, characters are so rad, and the Mines of Moria is such a cool scene.
Oh, yeah.
Or a sequence, it's a long time they're in there, but that, the whole Moria stuff, the staircase thing, and, it's like broken and they're falling, but also, Fellowship is dope. Fellowship is dope because they kill Gandalf and Boromir.
Oh, spoilers.
In that movie. Exactly. They kill Gandalf and Boromir in that movie, which, if you had no knowledge of Lord of the Rings and you're like, holy shit, like Gandalf died, Boromir died, and the movie's over. And the Fellowship is like splintered into all these different directions. Like everything, like
much just, like Empire, where everything feels like a
it
loss.
It ended like it was a failure. And I love that scene at the end when Gimli basically says that to Legolas and Aragorn. He's like, the Fellowship has failed, and like it was just, everything looks so down. And Aragorn just like gives him a little pep talk, and they go running off into the woods.
Yeah.
Friendship.
Yeah. Dude, and dude. I want to get since we're on Lord of the Rings, I just want to talk about how lame some parts in Two Towers are. The fucking, all the part with the Ents.
The Ents!
I don't, honestly, like, I used to kind of like this bit, but anymore, as an adult, I don't give a shit about Grima Wormtongue.
Fuck Grima.
And that whole plot line.
Fuck Grima. And, all right, like, I don't want to roast Two Towers too much of that.
Yeah, because it is a great movie.
But the end stuff sucks balls, and
does.
I know that the point of the scene is to, it's supposed to feel that way.
Yeah, yeah.
But
and I don't give a shit about Merry and Pippin fucking eating apples and finding tobacco and shit in that little like swamp thing.
Yeah, and then even like the Frodo, Sam, and Gollum. Gollum is great, and Andy Serkis is fucking tremendous.
Oh, absolutely.
But some of those moments, I'm just like
they draw on a little bit.
I just, my favorite parts of Two Towers are Aragorn, Legolas, and Gimli. And Helm's Deep.
Helm's Deep.
Helm's Deep. There it is. Helm's Deep is, I think, the best battle sequence in the entire trilogy.
Yeah, it's. I mean, even though Return is a bigger, grander stuff,
yeah,
that's probably one of the best battle sequences.
Yeah, oh, dude. Legolas fucking riding the shield like a skateboard or like a snowboard, shooting arrows. But yeah,
Gandalf coming in with the Rohirrim.
Yeah, dude,
so good.
But anyway. Yeah, Fellowship. Boom,
great movie. Okay. All right, you know I couldn't not do this.
Wait, hold on. Let me think for a second.
Yeah, I got nothing. I think he's gonna say The Room, but he already said it.
I think he's. I think you're gonna go with the whole.
You know what it is?
I know what it is.
What do you think it is?
What do I think it is?
Alright. To say,
you haven't done a horror movie yet.
As I was going to say, it's going to be a horror movie.
Alien is a horror movie.
Okay, but it's going to be a horror movie.
Barely.
It's going to be a horror movie.
You knew I couldn't not put a horror movie on here. Like a real horror movie.
Alright, alright.
Which one is it? And you guys know my favorites.
Okay.
Right, I'll give you three choices.
Okay.
No, three choices. You know me well enough. Okay, alright, fine. Huh? What do you think?
Wait, well, are you doing the choices?
No.
You said
no.
In your room, you have two posters of horror movies, okay?
As Shining.
The Exorcist, and you have Evil Dead.
And what?
And Evil Dead.
It's got to be either Evil Dead or The Shining. That has to be one of those.
I feel like The Shining would be a lame choice.
The Shining is my choice, you motherfucker.
I knew it.
I feel like The Exorcist is a stronger
choice. I agree.
I think, yeah.
I agree. Fuck you, Tom.
I don't think... Okay, look. Exorcist is a better horror movie than The Shining is.
Yes.
It's a more like oh my god, this movie's fucked up kind of thing.
Yeah.
The Shining, I think, is a better film. I mean, for me, I can watch it more. Mm-hmm. With The Exorcist, sometimes, you know, I'm not feeling, seeing this girl.
Let Jesus lick me, or
yes.
Fuck me.
Yes, yes.
Jesus lick me. Lick me.
Sometimes I'm not feeling that much. Like, and Jack Nicholson's performance is, like, off the fucking charts. And it's terrifying. Terrifying. It's like I can separate Jack Torrance from any other performance he's done. Mm. And I mean, of course, Shelley Duvall, a beauty. she really drags
that movie down.
She does a lot of harm to that movie, but I think like some of the better parts of that movie are like some of the greatest examples of like atmospheric horror. There are no cheap
jump scares or anything.
No cheap image. Like, then that's one thing with Exorcist is it does heavily rely on shock.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas I think The Shining relies a lot more on
digging under,
like giving you a real sense of claustrophobia and cabin fever with all these characters. And it's just a masterclass to me.
I don't disagree.
And I had to put it like it, not only did I have to put a horror movie in there, I also had to put a Stanley Kubrick movie in there. It was either that or A Clockwork Orange. And Clockwork Orange, I like you were saying, it was like I can't watch that movie regularly.
Would you consider 2001?
I would consider 2001. 2001 gets
a little scarier than The Shining.
It is scarier. It's in a more real sense, I think, than
I don't like watching it because there's like the beginning with all the monkeys and stuff.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah.
Scary scene.
It's a scary movie. It is. But I just think like as far as movies go, and I can watch I would pick The Shining over 2001 when like I'm going to watch a movie, and
I can't really watch 2001 by itself. I mean, unless you're like in for the long
haul. Yeah, it's a long fucking movie. Yeah. But
you've always like The Shining has always been one of your favorite movies for a long time.
And it's one of those things like this isn't like a sentimental thing. Mm. It's not for any reason. It was one of my mom's favorite movies and she introduced it to me.
Oh, cool. Okay.
And it was like one of the first the first horror movie I saw was It, but that's not a real horror movie.
Right.
This was like the first real movie that freaked me out.
Mm.
Like when I was going to bed, I was thinking about like the the decrepit naked old lady.
Oh god, it's so gross.
And just
that's what you were thinking about.
didn't mean to.
Just popped in your head. Like so it kind of gets under your skin a little.
Right, that movie really that's the point of that fucking movie is to get under your skin. Mm-hmm. It's not to like when you when you watch the Exorcist, you're like oh shit, you know what I mean? Yeah. That's disgusting.
Yeah.
With this one, you're just like I just feel uncomfortable.
Mm. Yeah, I don't know. I won't disagree with anything you said. I just personally, I always was pretty underwhelmed by The Shining for me. I just never really did it for me that much.
And you guys are also wrong. My next choice for a horror movie wasn't going to be The Exorcist. The Evil next Dead. One was going to not be Evil Dead. It was going to be The Thing.
Oh, The Thing. Okay, yeah. That was my third choice for
the movie. Is fucking awesome. Anyway,
I think I would probably put for me The Thing over Alien.
Really? Similar, I thought about that. Yeah. I did, but there's something about Alien that I think, like, Sigourney Weaver's performance better than Kurt Russell's.
Better performance. For sure. I agree with that. But
Kurt Russell is in Fast and Furious, though.
Kurt Russell is in Fast and Furious.
That's funny.
There's something about Kurt Russell. I just, gotta love
him. He's very burly.
Love me some Kurt.
I do, too. But, like, I just think that Alien's a better made movie too. It's another situation it's a better movie.
I agree with that. I think Alien is a better movie, and
but you Sigourney just like Weaver, the
I
just, thing
I think
more.
It's like The Thing a little bit thing. More. Yeah, it's a gut thing. Thing.
It's a gut thing.
It's a gut thing.
All right. On that note, that's it, right? I mean, that's, we've done all. Cool.
Did
so just to end it off, just to rattle off our five each. Mm-hmm. Just boom, 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 boom. So what are your five?
Whiplash, The Dark Knight, American Beauty, The Big Short, and There Will Be Blood.
I got Empire Strikes Back, Fellowship of the Ring, Pulp Fiction, Jurassic Park, and 12 Angry Men.
For me, it's The Shining, Empire Strikes Back, Pulp Fiction, Spirited Away, and Alien.
Dope. I never thought.
I got nothing here.
Mateo, Fast and Furious 8, Fast and Furious 7, Fast and Furious 6.
And Annie Hall, don't forget.
And then Annie Hall.
And Annie Hall, yeah.
I got silent.
Okay. I never thought. I didn't think to put an animated film. I should have done.
Don't worry. We'll add yours to the MDRM.
You will be spoken for.
Vern, another.
I'm gonna be real spiteful. All right.
Another shout out to a movie that almost made my list as the best, as my favorite animated movie, Iron Giant.
Ooh.
Ooh. Almost.
Hey.
The movie's fucking great.
That's a good movie.
Anyway,
that's a wrap, guys.
That's a wrap on this movie cast. So catch us on all the social medias. Our Instagram is popping now.
Yes,
Mateo's running the Instagram, so check that out at Modern Day Ren Men. But yeah, you can find us anywhere. So,
and
yeah.
We're apparently revamping the site from the ground up.
We're
going to bring it back to
thing.
Bring it back to formula.
Revamp.
Revamp.
All right, guys. New order?
Oh, God.
We got the new order site now. No longer Joy Division.
Stop this. Stop this analogy.
Revamp.
Bye, guys.
All right.